Okay, myself, I'm Vijay Preti. I'm in IT for nearly 22 years now. I have this interest of going for media talk and different technologies, especially I come from IT infrastructure background. So that's why I just wanted to know, like, how many of you will really be interested to know about infrastructure area of your cloud. But that's why I want to set the right expectation that why you write a code. When you do a cloud computing from the developer angle, why you write that? So this is where actually, when you think something from the architectural point of view, you be slightly different from what you are. As a developer, you've been assigned to do some kind of work on the design, and based on that design, you do some kind of create some workflows and then start doing your coding or whatever. Sorry, I'm not a developer, so it's unfair for me to speak more on the development side, but I'm just trying to say, what's the process you go through when you talk about development, right? But where you lack on the development area there, and this is the aim for my presentation here, and if any one of you can carry this message back to your company, back to your work, just one line statement, I think I'll see that I'm the winner for this presentation. The message is, whenever you write any code, think about the business value of that code that you're writing. That's what I ask you. Why you're writing code? If you are writing a code of 1,000 lines and there is no business value for that, there will be one fine day, the product team will say, I'm scrapping that code, the entire thing that you need of it. Right? There are some, you know, say, some direction comes from the higher end also to get you to do something. But I'm talking about the development that you do as a part of your innovative thinking. Something. But even if the innovation, some of you might be having your own startup and all, right? When you do these kind of things, you need to really see the value from business perspective. And that is where the architectural thinking comes in. Architecture is slightly different from design. We are not just, you know, a building architect kind of thing. But there also they think a lot from the budget versus design, right? That how your design maps to the budget being allocated and how the estimation of the design is going to be the value for money and I get the ROI out of that design. Is that the model that we use for? That's very good. So coming to this, there are different models of defining architecture. Enterprise architecture especially. When I say enterprise architecture, what I mean by that, you do architecture work at your level of, you know, defining of this specific area. You go a little large, then you think about a whole big large project. You go a little further on that, you think about, you know, defining something for your organization. You go a little further on that, you define something across the organization. You go a little further, you say global solution, right? Google, Gmail, whatever. But they might have started this morning in Facebook, right? These guys might have just started doing some coding and all, but turned out to be like, you know, globally accepted solution. So, enterprise architecture actually goes in a way to have your thinking for anything starting from the top to the bottom, that there is a cycle being defined, I'll come to that. That cycle drives you at every point of the cycle, be it from the business perspective, be it from, you know, a technical or technology architecture perspective. At every point it actually reminds you what is the requirement. Is that requirement being driven by the vision of the company or vision of the stakeholders which are part of that? And are we actually compliant to that design or not? In a nutshell, this is what I mean by when I say TOGAF architecture. Okay, so if someone of you don't even know what is TOGAF, TOGAF is actually open group, enterprise architecture model. It's a framework. Like in IDEA, you have a framework. Similar to that, there is a framework for, you know, enterprise architecture. Beautifully designed. And all these frameworks help you to ensure that you are able to optimize the solution that's being provided, that's being targeted for. You understand that where is the business requirement and how you are actually correlating that requirement and understand what is your, you know, baseline versus what is your target. And you do the gap analysis between the baseline versus target. And based on that gap analysis, you come to a solution either through a change management, through development, through whatever kind of processes that you go through. That's where it is together. It's actually a 34 or somewhere around that big number of slides, but looking at the audience and I see that's purely through a developer and trying to, you know, rush through some of the slides which may not really interest you or Google. I have little interest in writing, so I have written two books, one on operating system studying, and recently my book published, which is actually by Igloo. That is on, I have actually contributed to one of the chapters which is on cloud computing in developing nations. So, defining that how, what challenges developing nations are facing, what are the things in that. Anyway, just on the offside, you don't get distracted on my statement that. This is a simplistic model that I can talk about. Okay? And we will see that how this kind of model actually gets correlated well when we talk something in terms of cloud computing. And for all of you, please do not get disheartened by looking at something very, you know, some new jargons coming to your world and all. But again, all this is trying to say that when you do any kind of work in terms of or derive to anything in business value, you need to think what my, what company's vision is there, what they are looking for that to be done. I have written a code. Is it really giving me adding business value, or actually can be done smartly to reduce the, say, the time to complete the effort? So that's the kind of thing. I think the picture is not very clear, so some of you may not be able to read. There are some pictures which are just taken from book on source. Again, all of these presentation and slides are credited by Open. OpenGroup.org, because TOGAF is their authenticity, so I can't say something that, you know, this is my work. But I'm just trying to explain to you that what is there of that. So it starts with a very, very initial phase of preliminary phase, goes down to architecture vision, then business architecture, it goes to system architecture, that goes down to technology architecture, talks about opportunities and solutions. Solutions, you know, anything, but that's where you come to the development. Find the solution, you do the solutioning of your requirement. Then you define the migration planning, and how this is going to get deployed, what the implementation stage, what you're going to do. Then you define implementation governance of that, and finally architecture change management, which is a iterative process. Anything as a part of this entire process, you see that something is actually not met with the architecture vision, or whatever being stated as a part of SOW. How many of you know SOW? Statement of work, all senior people will do anything. So whenever you have been the client or stakeholder or whoever, you define something as a contractual agreement, right? You say that this is what is customer requirement, I need to meet these requirements, these kind of workflows, right? That's how it goes. So you want to read out, if you have patience, go ahead and read out, but all I'm trying to say out, yeah, please.
In this new world of where APIs are at the center, the developer is driving it, how does this come in? He's driving the business, right? There's no architecture. We start with the API, and you know, more people are using it. I built an architecture from the API.
That's why it goes into defragmented solution, right?
You are absolutely nailed it.
That's where this TOGAF kind of model comes in. You're absolutely right. Why do I need it? Right? But where it is required, here in the open world, your thought process makes perfect sense. Fine, I'm developing, I'm a startup, I find something that is good and deploy. But when you are actually being driven at the very preliminary stage and then come to the level of architecture vision, that's where it drives. What are my business requirements? Who are my business stakeholders? Am I really going to get to the ROI of what I'm doing? Coding is, see, you're, again, as I said, like, you need to slightly come out of your thought process of coding. And you need to think something beyond coding. Yes, there is something that why I'm doing the coding. Who are the users of that coding? Who are the, you know, end users of that? And am I really deriving anything as a business value to that coding? And that's where we define the very preliminary stage as when you say, what's going to be my future? Why am I actually looking to move to cloud solution? What are the benefits of moving to cloud solution? Do I really see a return on my investment? Because again, for a cloud solution, I might have to invest for developers, I might have to invest for having another architecture solution there, I'm talking about something who's having their own private cloud, not really on the public side, but the who will get it. This kind of architecture model works very well when you are talking about something from here, having a cloud model within your own environment, premises, private cloud kind of model, right? Or hybrid cloud, where you are actually trying to have mix of your architecture solution. So, absolutely right, you have the thought process of that, but that thought process comes from the open world kind of an environment. But when you are actually talking something that has to be driven with the company's vision, unfortunately, that vision does not get cascaded back to the level of developer.
Yeah, that's my question actually. You, in that picture, the requirement management at the central point.
Correct.
How to help it?
Okay, so my question, how to validate that requirement management with each and every part of the system?
So, see, as I said, this is a framework and anything with the framework is best practice, right? It's not something as a model that you need to have this, otherwise you are nowhere kind of thing. What this requirement management does is that every level, that's the beauty of this program architecture. What it says that every level, when I go through each of these sections of area, each of these areas need to actually verify, because they have to see where the requirement is being set. At the preliminary stage, when your business stakeholders are already defined, then you say, what is going to be my architecture design on a very large basis, coming from the business architecture, then go to that. So from here onwards, I start putting into something called, say architecture documents or architecture definition documents and all, I start creating all contractual documents and asset approvals and all. So this is an iterative process, keep that in mind. It is not that this is going to go here, and drop down, I'm done. No. That's why the change process at the last, there is an opportunity to go back to the cycle again. So that's the reason when we talk about something from the requirement perspective, the requirements are driven at the very top level. But then it has to be mapped each of the cycle areas to make sure that I'm meeting the requirement which has already been cascaded back from. Because those requirements are coming from the customer or from the business.
Can you look at the other way? The requirements are getting generated at every level and it comes to the central level at the architecture requirements management. While the architecture should look at from the other way what you're saying, how much I'm going to spend, what the value I'm looking, right? Yeah. It's not driven from the top, but I think at each and every stage, at least your diagram says, at each and every level, say from technology architecture I'm getting, from opportunity solutions I'm getting requirements. There will be some requirement on migration, which I could do with $50,000 or $5,000.
Absolutely, right? Absolutely correct. If you see, it's bi-directional. Okay, so it is not that it is giving information, it is taking information as well. So it's a bi-directional thing. What happens when you define architecture solution, right? What do you need to ensure that the architecture solution meets with the requirement? But if something that I need feedback as per the requirement of my current state of my business, I feed that information back onto my requirement, I take the requirement back. That's why it is two-way. You won't feel it actually going only one way. Yeah? Make sense?
Sorry.
So please keep asking.
There are some chocolates there. If someone asks.
Oh, yeah. I'm looking for that. I'd be happy to share chocolates.
Okay, you're the one.
Someone else over there. But please keep participating, because I am not expecting you to be a NoGap expert, I am not expecting you to know everything and end on that. But see the business value out of this presentation. As I said, like, this presentation is purely open source solution.
All the presentations from today we are going to share on
NoGap.com. Yeah, so you will be able to make use of those, not an issue. But from here, as a developer, when you go to the room, you won't be thinking just only, from say, thinking from the perspective of being just pure developer, but you might be start thinking architecture value, business value of this thing. Why am I writing a board? Ask your manager, ask your leaders, ask your seniors. What is the business value if I do these kind of things? Why can't I actually automate that? Now my hand is not even good.
Why don't you just take the mic?
Am I dancing too much?
Can you take the mic and do it?
Cool. Okay. Anyway, coming to this one. So, yeah.
Sure. So, let's try to understand that. So, first is, what is the input of this and what is the outcome from this?
You will come to know on each of these cases. This is a very high level. So I'll go to each of these cases.
So is it like every block has some outcome?
Yes, they all will have outcome. You see that outcome. So all of these, see what happens, absolutely very good question. And can I? You have a question to ask about chocolate or what? No way.
The question is, how do I get a chocolate?
How do I get a chocolate? Right? You can surely get it. See, I had two questions. See, every process, which is an iterative process, we need to make sure what are input in that process and what you are getting out of that process. Now, say for example, like the preliminary phase is not really input in the sense that what is coming from the stakeholder. Who all are the business stakeholder? What is the output? Defined as output. You define that what is the business requirement of that. That's what you mean output from the documentation, contractual documentation. You set the business requirement out of that, right? So that's the way I have them that, not to get disappointed on that, because there's a big four. As I said, 33 slides are there. I may have to rush on some of those, but still, if somebody has a question, I do not mind taking it. And even after the session gets over, you can anytime come to me, you can ask me. So coming to this one, so these are different actually areas. Focus only is onto this part of that. It only talks about strategy, segment, community, governance. There are something on the other side of the same business direction, which is separate, you know, product catalog, that's where they think the input is coming from. You are asking this question that where the input is coming from. There are existing catalogs, business catalog, product catalogs are there, they take the value out of those things. Someone who has worked on infrastructure understands the CMDB model, right? The configuration management kind of requirement. They take existing state of the environment from here, coming from there. Tools and development is completely separate activity. Taking, you know, your cloud as a model kind of thing. So that's where they have defined, but I'm not put that. This is where you see it. And that's where I was coming to it. That's what I was talking to you about. What happened? Bruce is, this guy is really getting, he must, you know, impressed as to how I'm going to get very out of what's been happening here. And this is what he does. He thinks a lot about reducing the cost of IT. He thinks about, you know, reducing data center footprint. So he has two different things if you look at it, right? Mutually exclusive. One way, he wants to reduce the cost of IT, but at the same time, he doesn't want to invest onto anything else because his budget has to go down. But he still wants to have very much updated with the latest coming to the technology. So he needs to be latest with the technology, but at the same time, he has a budget constraint. So look at it, how many things are going in CEO's mind. That's why I'm saying, please think about this. The CEOs, the CTOs go through this kind of pain. If we understand that pain, whenever I'm writing a single line in the code, I need to understand what is the business value to this guy. So cascade it back. I don't think anybody in any company discourages you to say that. How that code can be written smartly if it gives a business value to that. That's what all I'm trying to say. I'm trying to correlate from the developer idea because I'm not in development, so I'm just trying to see where you see the value in that. So that's the kind of thing which is good. So you ask for that, what happens in the preliminary stage, you define different things. These are the questions. Where, why, what, all kind of W questions that you can think about it. Why am I doing it? Where am I going to deploy the solution? Take it from the cloud idea. Who are, you know, stakeholders for that? Who are the ones who are going to utilize this capability? How do I define the architecture? How do I do the modeling? What are the things which are going to be input and which are going to be the output of that? Those things are defined. So basically, you define the strategy for the consumption management of cloud. I won't go to the reading out all those things. You can definitely read it, but this is something interesting I need to talk about. Yeah.
Okay.
Say, so you define architecture principles. You see, anywhere when you, you know, when you grow in your life, you define certain principles to say that for me to be at the right path, I need to follow certain principles on that. That's what I define. There are certain business principles I need to actually take into account before I take, you know, my entire sort of a cloud cycle of development practices. So there are two major things on that. Who owns the service from service perspective and who owns from the user's perspective, right? So who are the end user and who are the service providers for that, right? So from both ends we see that. So if you see that from the architecture principle, being specific to, you know, being specific to say cloud computing, these are the things that you look for. And which is like, you know, say what are the features of cloud? Where do I see a value addition being on a cloud? Say cloud tools are designed to address performance variation which are not. Do I really see that, you know, it is scalable as being committed? Do I see that it is providing the availability that is expected to provide? So those are the kind of things. Does it really give me abstraction layer to, you know, hide all the backend infrastructure and I only see a front end from the end user perspective that I just click buttons and my job is done. I don't have to worry about getting into any kind of infrastructure. That way you all work on cloud ops and all those kind of things, right? So this is the thing that helps to design that. And
you want to use this mic? Is it disturbing?
Yes.
Yes.
You can keep it.
So at the preliminary phase, what we define is that what are the business drivers for that, what are the things I am going to be taking out of this thing. And if I go to the very first phase, which is because your actual architecture start from architecture real phase, which is called the phase one. This is where I start, because at the very top level from the preliminary, I just get a requirement, right? If this is what happens, someone who works on pre-sale engineering, pre-sale kind of work, they just get a requirement and they analyze it, that how requirements are there, how is it fitting into my business model, what different stakeholders are there, what all things are there, the problem goes on. Yeah, you all can hear me, right?
Yeah.
Maybe this will not hear. So, I'm very loud. So what happens, like, so from the business angle, what you look for is, what are your, business requirement and how you can translate those requirements back to, architecture sort of model. So what happens on the architecture vision phase, this is the very first time you can read it very well. The enterprise architecture team collaborate with the business, understand the scope, the need, and align them with the strategic enterprise architecture. So understand the business need. So there are two things on that. One, company will have their own architecture model, right? Some company will adopt their architecture, but they will have their existing architecture. I'm not about something that's coming as a fresh and starting startup. They may have their model for defining, you know, architecture solution. Now you bring in something as a two-gap model architecture. What is this trying to say that? Just make sure that your solution is aligned to the enterprise architecture model that you already have. What capabilities you have? You may give your client an offer to say, I can provide you X, Y, Z services as a part of this model. But when you look at your enterprise architecture solution, you don't even have that capability on that one. So this is kind of a matching your existing capability versus the business requirement. So that's what you do at business scale. So validate business goals, objective, ensure that architecture principles are aligned. Document business requirement, this is what you are trying to say, that what is going to be the architecture, you know, output out of those things. Because unless you document it, there are different, you know, documentation mechanisms. I can share the link on to what different documents are there. I can't go into those details. But yes, I mean, you need to document it, you need to create different framework, you need to create different metrics out of those things. that what is going to be the impact of each of these areas that I'm talking about with respect to the different verticals or different, you know, the area that I'm going to be targeting on. Ensure the organization model for enterprise architecture in annual business goals, that's fine. Obtain formal approval for architecture work from client, cloud ecosystem. So, obviously, once you have defined all those things, once you have seen the requirement, once you have analyzed the requirement, make sure you have a blessing coming from business stakeholders as well as, now, business stakeholder is a very, you know, can even anyone of you tell me what do you understand by business stakeholders? Who are those? Who are those business stakeholders?
Sponsor. Someone who sponsors.
Someone who sponsors and?
Vendors and suppliers.
Sorry?
Vendors and suppliers. Service consumers are also the business stakeholders.
Consumers, not the vendors. Vendors, this is supporting. So, see, you're, when we talk about, business stakeholders. So there are two angles to business stakeholders. Somebody asked you a question? Okay. See, two aspects of business stakeholder. One is that, who's the consumer? Someone is that, who is actually invested on the company. So there will be some internally, when you are building a cloud as a model, there will be business stakeholder within a company as your employee, or somebody who want the cloud solution to be there. So all of these who are the end users of the cloud model, or cloud solutions, they are going to be business stakeholders. And that's where which is coming at, you know, overall goals. You were asking what is the goal for each of these areas. This is where it comes from. So I'll just summarize all that. If you find, have patience to read it, read, but I can just quickly go through one or two areas which is very much critical to this, business type of that. Which can, identify stakeholders, concerns and business requirements. That's what I've been repeating every time.
So this is more for an enterprise which is just now getting into the cloud. Is it something like that?
No.
What the target, when you say an enterprise?
Yes.
For example, an enterprise is already an AWS, already an everything, right?
That's right. Okay. See, this model.
So what are the target enterprise?
Yeah, so this model will not work if it is for, a vendor-driven third party. I think I made this statement, right? That if you have your private cloud model, okay, if you're developing a cloud solution, that's where the enterprise solution will come. See, if you have given it to, say, offshore to someone, you can't do anything with that. I mean, it's most of the things are already being done. Maybe at the very, if you really are much interested in that, you can go for defining a cloud operating model, basically. That's where you go into SLAs, OLAs, and those kind of things get defined with vendors and all. But you're limited for defining an architecture solution. You already have an architecture solution. What more you need to do? Maybe some consulting on to say, take these offerings from AWS or from maybe Azure or somewhere, and make use of those offerings and see what best fits you. But that's the only thing. But as far as the cloud, from the solution point of view, you don't have any scope to do much on that. But when you're defining something as private cloud in your environment, that's where enterprise architecture solution for the vision phase, who are going to be my client? What are going to be their requirement? Are they, is my infrastructure Linux based or Windows based or some other operating system based, HPUS based or whatever, Solaris based? So I need to have these clarity before I get to a model. So that's where the architecture vision phase, you look at all of these aspects, not just the business, but what you have existing. So there's something called baseline architecture and then something called target architecture. So you have your baseline architecture which is already existing. You move to have a target architecture, and then you do a gap analysis between those two. Right? And that's where you see the business value out of those gap analysis. So, fine, define a scope. I think we can just read it if somebody is doing it, but I'll share it anyway.
One question.
Yeah.
You mentioned business capabilities. What does it mean? What kind of capabilities actually? Is it like operational or technical or the people there?
No, existing business capability, as I told you, will the business be able to take those requirements? What I mean by business capabilities is my existing infrastructure is capable enough to meet those business requirements. That's why you need to see that. Do I have the business capability to run that? If I don't have that capability, I can't really drive my solutions. I need to be very careful in terms of taking my solution. If I have got right skill within my team, I've got right infrastructure within requirement, I have right budget for that, and that budget being agreed by all stakeholders to say that that's the way forward.
That's where, and somebody has already done an analysis to say that within 3 years down the line, you will start seeing ROI. Maybe first year, you will have to just put some more investment on that. But maybe down the line, 2 years, 3 years, you will start seeing return of investment because you will not be investing much time on, you know. Basically, I think everybody knows it. What is the cloud for? What is the cloud solution for? What? Why we went for cloud? Anybody can tell me? having a mid-range kind of infrastructure. They have good ideas, they have all these plans in place, but they can't afford to spend money on that. They don't know whether their company is going to survive because of that model for another 1 year or not. They say, fine, for 1 year I can pay, because once you have bought the infrastructure, you can't do anything with that. So they go with the cloud model. But this is not very true all the time, that in the cloud model, you will always be able to save the cost. Definitely, driver at the back end, it will be there. But the push for moving to cloud has been purely from optimization of resources. The resources getting wasted too many. I mean, take it from power dissipation, take space, take whatever. I have worked on data center for years, so I don't know. I know how much it was waste of total resources. So anyway, so stakeholder concerns are, if you see, this is where actually these becomes another reason when you say the driver as well as like stakeholders, that what stakeholder thinks, and like say corporate stakeholders and then internal stakeholders. Do you remember I told you that there are two different kinds of stakeholders? One is going to be from corporate side, company level. One is going to be an internal stakeholder who will drive this cloud solution. So they will also be stakeholder, right? Stakeholders means someone who is waiting for some solution to be completed, some kind of value to be coming out of those things. So who will be seeing the value? The program management office will see that. The cloud operation support team will see the value, how efficiently I'm doing, how automation is being derived out of those things. Cloud business support kind of model. If you have better business support, you will be able to drive it better. So that's the way it is. Sorry, I'm being a little fast now because we are only into phase one and we still have to do a 7 minutes out there. So now I can see actually interest is going slightly away, so I just want to wrap it. But don't hesitate to ask questions. So this is just an illustration, but saying that like how you can define your viewpoint through, like say, at the very top I showed you a CEO having like a pain of all those areas, and this is where it comes to. Chief Financial Officer thinks from the avoid capital investment with the long run ROI, and like CIO will think about from the data perspective or from security perspective, to what all things they need to really be careful about. And then CIO mainly talk about the data and all, like how those things work. So your chief CIO of the thing from the security engineer. These are just models, that's the way it goes. So you have business readiness. So basically what you do at this stage, you say that what are the different levels, you define the readiness test to basically define the priority level. Please don't go much over these things if you don't understand, because I have better things to really talk about on those. I made this specific one for you to understand. Define the target architecture value proposition and KPI. That's the big vision of your architecture. If you don't have KPI, what is KPI? There you go. So if, and how this KPI will be derived out of having a stakeholders expectations kind of thing, that's why you will derive the KPI for that. If it is not derived, this is just an example. Procurement of cloud service will be at least 20% cheaper in the development. Just an example. These are the kind of things that will be deriving out. You had a question, right? That how you derive, what is the motivation to go to cloud and load those things? That year you will see that will I be able to provide more high available solution, elastic solution, a scalable solution kind of thing? This is it. So again, a target architecture, some kind of a modeling has been given here. Suppose you have a on-premise cloud or public cloud or maybe outsourced private cloud or community cloud kind of thing. So that's fine, everybody knows that thing. And from those who are from the pre-sale, we'll be able to understand what I'm talking about in the architecture business perspective. What happens, it takes on obtaining the deal agreement, which is what is SOW. It goes through the process of validating business principles, define the scope through high-level architecture design, because you define high-level design at the architecture vision level, which is a very high level. What happens, right? Solution architecture is going to be there at the time when the pre-sale work happens. Is anyone here from the pre-sale or something? Okay, that's why I see a complete blank face here. You have been on that. You understand that, right? That's okay. I mean, anybody else? Pre-sale is nothing but just before the sale. They have an engineering angle. So what happens? They don't just say that, I can do it for you. Typically, and then one small thing where it went wrong for, Sun Microsystem for selling their T2000 servers. They were horizontally scaled servers. I think they were the first one actually who came up with the solution of defining 32 compute thread or 128 compute thread. I have worked on 256 compute thread servers. You know where it actually failed? Sorry. Where it failed? It failed because of the sales people were not able to, you know, sell it well by defining that what it means by having compute thread. They said you will have this much of compute power. You developer know what is compute threading. Right? It is not a compute power. You can say core is a computing power, but not really compute thread. That is just for horizontally scaling solution. You can have, you know, more you can define more throughput coming in, right? More pipeline basically, throughput coming in. But every thread is going to process in the same way. You will not be seeing actually, you know, say power or CPU power is going to get increased. You will only see the throughput is going to get increased. They didn't understand that, and that actually product became a fail. It was such a, I mean, beautiful product. They sold it out by saying that you will get such a big performance, and then they started blasting. You committed blah 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 whatever. Please do not record this. Remove this from our recording. Anyway, some microsystem is not there anymore, so who cares? So anyway, this guy appropriate solution for target architecture, where it's going to be. Business architecture. Now, quickly I'll have to go through. So one line statement for business architecture, when you define that, what is the business value you see out of that, you know, the vision phase architecture that you define. Now from here onward, I start, you know, jotting down what different business value areas I see. Like, maybe one line I can leave for you. So it ensures that the business strategy organization is structured on governance, business process information, as well as interaction between these industries are well defined. Somebody will ask you that when you
have. Sir, I have a question. So this is a like.
Hey, if you don't mind, you'll have to give me another 5 minutes. Yeah.
Sorry. So this architecture, like, can you give some example, like a use case? So like, why we should use this?
This is purely coming from the cloud. This is an example. Your cloud services are going to be like.
Correct. So let's example. I want to start a like business, an e-commerce, say
right.
Fruits.
Right.
So it needs server and all.
Right.
So it might be my on-premise machine. It can go into the cloud.
Right.
So when we should do this kind of like a model.
Correct.
To
why you do it?
Conclusions. That this is things we should follow.
Right. So suppose you are starting a new company, or maybe you said that you are setting up a new infrastructure for the cloud and all, right? Before starting anything, what do you need to look at? You need to see the business value coming out of it, right? That's going to be very first driver for that. Then as you said, like, you know, cost effective, and you see that whatever, it's part of the same business value, right? Then you see it, what is my existing infrastructure? Will I be able to go to that? Where things fail, and that's what I'm again trying to say that. Come little out of your developer thinking, think from the largest perspective, the bird's eye view of your organization. Think from that perspective. I only, being a developer, maybe senior developer kind of thing, we only think from the area or the project that we worry about. You think from the business angle that somebody has to drive this, because somebody is spending maybe, you know, crores of money on deriving something. If it doesn't follow all these processes and standard, because what happens, these processes and standard help you to drive in a more, you know, refined way to reach to a company. If I don't do that, fine, most of the companies are not even following that. But that is where they do not see the business value coming out of that. You know, why this agile model and those things came up? People are still having fun, it's fine. Developers think their own ease time, you don't know that, right? Why they came up saying, no, I need to reduce their time. Sorry, don't blame me, I'm not against the developer, but I'm just trying to say, that was the drive for them, right, to ensure that there is a fast development activity going on. Same thing for any of these models. Again, this is just a framework. This doesn't say that you only follow this. What it says is that whichever area you are into, make sure you are following those areas. Okay? So that at the end, it's like being an organized way, as simple as it is. I need to have my, you know, policies defined. I need to have my security definitions are defined. I need to have my network architecture being well defined. I need to have my system architecture being well defined. I'll just show you one slide. Here you go. That's the way you sit. You define here, having a meeting with the CTO to say what all things I need to define from my business architecture angle. And if I don't define that, will still run. But where they fail, the project which was supposed to be taking 6 months might take 2 years. And what happened? What's wrong with that? The product which is supposed to go live in 6 months goes after 2 years, product had no value. The already computer is already gone live on that. So this model, or this kind of going through this cycle of model, helps you defining that what is going to be my business architecture, where I define the architecture vision, what is being my initial preliminary, where I say that what has been expected from my as an organization, from me as an organization, what has been expected out of my all stakeholders putting so much of money on that, what is their outcome, what is the outcome, what I'm going to be driving out of those things.
Can you say it as a systematic approach to bring a thinking process into all the stakeholders?
Yeah.
That can drive all of them together on the same road for the mission.
Okay, you got the chocolate, but I'll get to that. See, this is where actually we might get into some kind of chaotic thing when everyone actually goes and say, I want to drive this, I want to drive that. I think you might have seen in companies, right? The same product being developed in the same company with three different models. Same requirement has come. Nobody knows about these things. Nobody knows actually. I recall from my previous organization, I will not name now. I have already named two companies. I will be having big trouble if I name again. Please do not record. All I'm trying to say, they have duplication, triplication of the same product being actually developed by some other team there. The stakeholder requirement. What happens this way? Your organization requirement has come. You are being methodological to drive it to the conclusion that how the requirement is coming in, how do I define my architecture vision, how do I say that this architecture vision is meeting with my business requirement, then I say what is the base architecture, what is target architecture, and then how do I define my gap analysis and all. These are being the driver to make sure my end result is actually coming via this process. Again, this is not a process that you say that as an automated, something as a tool kind of thing. This is a framework. What they say that, like I'll give you an example. There's something called as a R board, architecture review board. I'll give you, this is the best example. I think I can wrap up after this one. We've already 3 minutes are there now. There's something called architecture review board. Maybe you can note it down. What happens and where we see the problem coming in? If the requirement is coming in, it goes directly to the development team, they do their whatever things, and then all of a sudden they realize, oh man, we didn't capture this requirement clearly. Oh, network has this kind of bottleneck. Oh no, storage does not have this capability. I came to know all of a sudden that, no, my tools actually cannot integrate to this level. It has a defined capability. So what will happen if I already have my architecture footprint already being defined, what is my existing architecture footprint? What happens in architecture review board, they all sit together who are SMEs in each area. So you will have SMEs, I think I have a slide for them, I'll just show you. Give me 1 second, I'll just show you that one. So this is basically just saying that cloud business strategy planning on that. That's what I told you all, right? You might have heard of this thing, ad, right? Kitna de diye. उसके लिए आता ना कार के लिए यूसी अप्लाई है उसके लिए इफ यू डोंट अंडरस्टैंड दैट बट दैट्स व्हाट ही सेज दैट हाउ मच इट गिव्स व्हाट वैल्यू अबाउट बिजनेस वैल्यू इट इज गिविंग दैट्स व्हाट इट इज इफ इट डजंट ड्राइव बिजनेस वैल्यू दिस गाय इज नॉट रियली मोर एफिशिएंट टू दैट राइट सो बट वेयर आर यू कमिंग टू ऑन टू दिस वन बिकॉज़ वी आर सीरियसली रनिंग शॉर्ट ऑफ टाइम एंड वी नीडेड अ डेडिकेटेड आवर ऑफ टाइम टू डिफाइन दिस लेट्स सी गाइस दिस इज व्हाट आई एम टॉकिंग अबाउट आर्किटेक्चर इन बोर्ड व्हाट यू डू इन दैट You will have SMEs from say cloud development lead or whatever it is, who has already defined the cloud architecture. You will have platform leads. What do I mean by platform lead? Network lead is going to be, SME is going to be there on that. And this is a practical thing. In my previous organization, I can name that target corporation. They were applying this R model. Every requirement which would come in solution, architecture will just define a solution. It will come to us, we will have architecture review board meeting every week. All of these SMEs and experts are going to be from each of these areas and they will discuss whether this model fits into our existing capability or not. You have capability mapping? Fine. you will see which are the areas automation is required to be done. You will see which all areas I need an improvement to be done. This is where you see the value of, you know, having a developer kind of one. You define an architecture review board. So any requirement which comes in has to go via this architecture review board. Jump in there, they will say, go back, no, I don't accept your requirement, it doesn't mean. Go back and do some kind of tweaking on that, see what other thing can be done. We have, as part of our board, we had rejected one, you know, requirement coming in just because it was not meeting our standard, it was not meeting our limitation, whatever we had in our company.
A curious question, as an end user who has, they have a requirement, they have a problem or, you know, they want a solution, right? Yeah. And they are proposing a requirement, correct. And that comes to your board, right?
Right?
And your board, you know, you don't have the capability to handle it, but
correct.
They really need it to, you know,
correct.
Really earn the money, right?
Correct.
What do you do then?
No, see, there are two angles. No, absolutely. Again,
no, the point is, you know, I'm just trying to put it.
No, absolutely.
I understand enterprises happen, but
I'm
just putting this question.
Your thought process is always right on that. My point of discussion on those things that if you're, see, you can take any new which is coming, you do not have capabilities, that's completely separate. But that's an investment. That's going to be like a complete investment, and you can still go with the architecture model to say that how much, where all I can fit it. Because if you're going with a new model of your solution, then you need to see how you can grab that capability. You need to see that if I have to grab this capability, what is going to be my investment on that? And then you also have to analyze that after down the line sometime, will I be able to generate ROI out of those solutions? It still goes to see, another point I need to tell you, you saw that this ADM cycle, that architecture development cycle, right? Togap. The beauty of this cycle is that at every point, you can generate another cycle. So at the business level, you can actually come out of that level and you can generate the same cycle inside that to see that for that business requirement, only for that division, or maybe only for that area, I can have a complete domain model there itself. So I can define, as you said, for a new business requirement, I can define what is the business requirement they've already agreed upon. I may not have a capability, but what I may have agreed to say that, fine, I don't have a capability, but I can estimate to do that. But ideally speaking, if you see in most of the company, if they are expecting or they are committing onto something they do not have a capability, that's a disaster. You are not supposed to be committing where you do not have capability. You build that capability and then commit to customer. Think about it, that how long it will take for you to first build that capability within your environment. You may need to, you may require to, you know, get required resources for that. You may, see, this is what happens, right, in service industry. We sometimes do not have that capability. So we can do it with cheaper and blah 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 whatever. At some point of time, you get such a frustrated customer. Finally, he says after 5 years, sorry, enough, I can't really continue on those kind of things. You need to have defined model. What are my capabilities? What all can I drive? And then where are the areas of improvement? That's a different thing. That is not a capability issue. That is something that I see as a part of gap. That this is the base architecture. This is where I am trying to be reaching out as a part of my cloud model, and that's where I need to see the gap analysis on that. But you have a point, but we can't, completely cannot just say that because every time I get a new requirement, do I need to go with the cycle? No, this talking about is cycle of, you know, enterprise as a solution. We are talking right now a specific requirement. I do not say that. I am talking about enterprise as a whole, business as a whole. If something is coming up, some stakeholders have asked you to do something, to develop something, how you are going to go with that cycle. So this is where you can take a note of this video. Yeah, sorry. I have another chocolate before you start. Yeah, please.
So as part of this model, like, do we have any timelines defined? Because today, it is a fast-paced market, like, you wanted
really... Correct.
Market.
That's why you say, right, process takes a lot of time. Do we really need to go with that process?
No. I mean, of course, I am pro-taking a process because it's important,
right,
so that you don't have surprises suddenly but at the same time, timelines are important. Otherwise, this loop keeps going on because it's
correct.
A continuous loop.
Correct.
Vicious
loop.
Where should
stop? So this is where, no, absolutely right. When you think from the loop will go on, not at the area that you are actually thinking on, the loop will go from the business vision perspective. See, what will happen, it will go through the complete cycle, where it will go, you know, at later on you will see that a stage coming for what you call, say, opportunity, when we define the solution for the client, right? It will go through all these phases and it will go to the phase of, say, you know, say migration planning and all. You define that how this is going to be and then implementation kind of stage, where you say that how this is going to get implemented. That's perfectly fine. But the thing is that, again, as I said, this is just a framework for you to make sure, instead of having defragmented solution, nobody knows what, who's doing what. This is just ensuring that you are being driven, every project, every development requirement is being driven from the business solution, from the, say, preliminary stage, what has been committed to the client, what has been committed as a part of SOW, what has been committed as part of contractual requirement. If, as far as I'm abiding to those rules, as far as I'm, see, what happens when you say that, listen, I should be given a flexibility, why I'm actually wasting so much of time to, you know, go through these processes. But you know what, sometimes as a developer, they do not get the right idea in terms of the timeline as to when they need to define it or when they need to do it. What happens with these kind of architecture model, they help you to say, this is the target for the business, this is where it has to be done, it is down the line, it is getting cascaded, and it get cascaded to the level of developer to think in a view. And again, I started my statement with the same thing. When you are writing a code, think from the business perspective. Is it giving you business value or not? So right now what happens? I write a code. I enjoy coding and I like that, and I'll be boosting about, you know what, I can write thousands lines of code and this and that. I have come across a lot of, you know, experts and development committee and all. They boost about, I have written 1,000 or 10,000 or 50,000 lines of code and all. But is it really giving business value? So coming to your point that sometimes processes, as you rightly smile at, it actually takes your life for hell. But then you still need to define some standards. You need to be focused on the business goal. If you're not focusing on the business goal, there are always going to be, chances of actually getting somewhere diverted. And that's where I gave you an example that when the same product is actually, you see that if you enterprise huge organization, you see that same product is being driven by or built by, you know, 3-4 different teams and all. Nobody knows who is doing what.
What you are talking about is kind of like requirements driven architecture.
Right.
It's like that.
It's my duty, not yours.
So what I'm asking is, like, say for example Amazon, right?
Right.
If Amazon was doing this, they would have become Walmart. They would never have spin off AWS.
No,
right?
For your information, all of these, when you say, because you are thinking now from Amazon, from your side, client side. Amazon is a company, or Google is a company. When they build their, say, you know, cloud model, look at which actually enterprise architecture solution they follow. They all follow this. See, all of these, this is where we do not get into this model. We are very chaotic, right? I think how many of you agree to that? We work in a very chaotic environment. You will find it, right? Things are there, they are more, hardly we see something organized. We are chaotic. No. These kind of things make you actually being more organized, so that you're what happens, we see that I'm wasting time in this. But company looks from this perspective. They say, I don't care about this time, I care about time from here to here. And that time actually get reduced if you are following a process which is under a defined goal. If everybody is focused to that goal, you will be able to complete the better cycle. But if you are actually being diverted, my requirement is this, fine, somebody has asked me to put focus on that, job done. Now, it will be 3-4 months, and it will go on and on for 3 or 4 years or whatever. Who knows? I think some of you might have seen it, right? There have been projects which are going for years and all. Somebody having good fun, they got a code for, you know, everybody is happy, paid 15 lakh, who cares about this thing? Who cares for code 15 lakh? But at the end of the day, are you really giving me business value? So all I'm trying to say, it looks to be that all of these processes and framework and all is just adding additional burden or no. It is just that it is setting into some kind of a, focusing into a vision and three major areas. Vision, baseline architecture, target architecture, and gap analysis. Four things rather, I would say, instead of three. Four. If you focus on that, you're done.
I'm sorry, I need to cut you off.
Your chocolate is done?
I need to cut you also off.
Yeah. No, we can take off. It's too late, seriously, because it's lunch time is already there.
Yeah. No.